you for him who has become our light and has become unto us the light of eternal life. Thank you that the darkness has already disappeared and the true light is already shining, and that it will continue shining progressively and increasingly unto the perfect day. Thank you for this wonderful witness of Scripture, which is accompanied by our wonderful experience in this regard. Enable us to experience this to the glory of your name. Lord, we wait upon you to give us light, the light of knowledge and understanding, the light of wisdom, the light of joy, and the light of power, and exposing the works of darkness in order to become light in the Lord more fully, so that the light will expose the darkness and overcome it in your body, the church, until our light shall shine perfectly until the perfect day. And on that perfect day, we pray for Christ's sake that I will be able to preach about this in the power of your Spirit, and that you will grant us understanding and the ability to apply, and so that exactly what has been said will happen, because this is your true word. Amen.
Amen.
I wanted to move to another aspect of our theme, namely our need of putting on Christ as our armory, with regard to all aspects and respects. But it is as if I've been kept back. I wanted to speak tonight about Christ as our peace, and I thought I would just do the little last bit about Christ as our armor of light. But then the sermon within 15 minutes became so, it increased so much that I will only be able to deal again for a third time with Christ as our armor of light. So, tonight again, and my title this evening, let us put on our Lord Jesus Christ as our armor of light increasingly, and win all in the process. Let us put on our Lord Jesus Christ as our armor of light increasingly, and win all in the process. And could we now ask original scripture verse? We could read the entire verses 11 to 14 of Romans chapter 13, but we won't do so. Let's only read our actual scripture verses, namely verse 13b and 14, or 12b and 14. Romans chapter 13, verse 12b. But let me rather read the entire verse 12. The night is far gone, the day is at hand. So therefore let us cast off the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. Verse 14, put on the Lord Jesus Christ. Put on, in an increasing manner, our Lord Jesus Christ as our armor of light. Okay, first point tonight. We are living in an already existing reality. Christ has already accomplished what we find in 2 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 10. 2 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 10. Let us read verse 9 in order to get some context. The power of God, for the gospel by the power of God, who saved us and called us to a holy calling, not because of our works, but because of his own purpose and grace, which he gave us in Christ Jesus before the ages began. Verse 10, and which now has been manifested through the appearing of our Savior, Christ Jesus, who abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. What does Paul say here? He says many things, but let's focus on one point, the main point. When Christ appeared, and he fulfilled as the God-man his ministry in this world, he died savingly, salvifically on Calvary's cross, and he rose from the dead in the fullness of new life as the glorified Christ, and he went to heaven in the power of the Holy Spirit in order to reign from the right hand side of the Father, in the name of the Father, for our benefit, for the benefit of his body, yes, for the benefit of his elect people. What Christ has done is he has already brought life and immortality to light. He has brought light and immortality to light. The more I study this, and I had another 35 minutes today to study it all, the more I see that light and life are connected. Each Sunday I see it in all the verses. Christ has brought light to light, life and light and immortality. Now, what does that mean? Life and immortality to light. We already saw last time and on the previous occasion, second Sunday from last, that according to John 1 verse 4, the light shone in the darkness and the darkness could not overcome it. The opposite happened, and that Christ was the life of men. I didn't quote it quite correctly. Let us quickly turn to it and listen to it. Check it out. John chapter 1. Gospel of John. Verse 4, in him, in the Logos, in the Word was life, and the life was the light. So Christ as the life is the light. There's no light shining where life is not. Christ is the eternal life of God because God has put his life in his Son, the God-man, according to 1 John 5:11. And therefore, when we receive life, we know that we have received light. The light of, firstly, knowledge and understanding, as opposed to ignorance, the darkness of ignorance, and stumbling around in the dark, spiritual darkness. Secondly, the light of joy in the Lord as the fullness of life and light. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. This light and this life, which is a person, the two constitute a person or reside in a person, namely in the Lord Jesus Christ. He is this. The more we have of Christ, the more we have of the true knowledge and wisdom of God, and the more we have of the light of God. We need these two more than anything else. Light and life. Because when man fell into sin, he lost what God intended him to be, namely the one who had an Amos 3, verse 3 agreement with God, to walk with him, having knowledge of God's will. And as he walked with God in Eden before the fall, he was filled, even his body was filled with radiant light, even physical light, I think, most probably. But in any case, with the light of God in a spiritual sense. So knowledge of God and of God's will enables us to walk in his light, and the more we walk with him in his light, the more we experience the abundance of his life. So, but Christ as the life is our light. And the more we put him on, according to our scripture verse, according to Romans chapter 13, verse 12b and 14, the more we experience him as our armor of light. You will realize that that is a practical verse. There's an application to be made. We must, in faith, continue putting on Christ as our light to experience him always more and in an ever-increasing manner as our fullness of life. Now, all the scriptures that I have studied during the 35 minutes or more or less that I had, I saw it all over the place. These two remain connected. You cannot separate these two. Do you remember John 8 and verse 12? John 8 and verse 12. Again, Jesus spoke to them saying, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light. Of what? The light of what? The light of life. So, because we walk in Christ, because we have received him, we continue to have the light, which is also the life. This is true life. True light, this is what God had for us from all eternity past, from eternity past. But we will not stumble. We will not walk in darkness, meaning we will not walk in ignorance. We will understand increasingly. And the better we understand, the more we receive Christ as our light, in the sense that we put him on as our wisdom, according to 1 Corinthians 1:13, God has made him to be our wisdom. Because according to Colossians 2:9, all God's treasures of knowledge and wisdom reside in him. And therefore, according to Colossians 2:10, you have the fullness of God's knowledge and wisdom in him. I've told you many times, also during this small mini-series, that we should never seek any gift from God outside of our Lord Jesus Christ. God only gave us one gift, the fullness that in his Son. In which way do we experience that fullness? We experience it by experiencing the Lord Jesus Christ. And when do we experience him? As we continue putting, trusting in him in faith. And in increasing faith and a reliance upon him. The more our knowledge increases, the more our life increases, because this light always brings more of his life. The two are intertwined and part of the same spiritual reality. So Christ is our light. Christ is our knowledge. Christ is our wisdom. Christ is our understanding. And isn't it wonderful to know that we shall never walk in darkness? We will always know what to do. I read a terrible verse in the first letter of John. John says that those who walk in darkness, they do not know where they are going, because the darkness has blinded their eyes. The darkness of ignorance, spiritual ignorance, blinds. And the people move around in all directions and they do not know where they come from, they do not know where they are headed. They do not have the foggiest idea. They do not have an inkling. But it is different in our case. Because a day came when 2 Corinthians 4 verse 6 took the place of 2 Corinthians 4, verse 2-4. You know that we have spoken about it, but let's do so again. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, Praise God that it never came to this fullness of darkness in our case. Because we belong to God's elect people. He didn't allow this to happen. Listen to this. Let's read verses 3 and 4. If our gospel is veiled, it is veiled in the case of many people. They listen to the true gospel as it is preached in the power of the Holy Spirit. And through the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, we saw light and immortality has been brought to light. It has been made known. But because there's a veil over their eyes, they are in spiritual darkness. The light is blocked off. And they cannot see it. And therefore, the gospel remains veiled. It remains a mystery to them. It remains foolishness unto them. To those who are in the process of perishing until they will perish eternally in hell. In their case, only in their case, verse 4, the God of this world, Satan, has blinded the minds of the unbelievers. Has blinded the minds of the unbelievers. There is darkness in their thinking. And Satan made the darkness even greater by keeping them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ. Christ, who is the image of God. If your wife is lost, and if she has been hardening herself, she has had darkness in her, the darkness of ignorance, of not understanding, and Satan, by her willful neglect of the gospel, and her stubbornness and rebelliousness, she allowed the God of this world to make this light, this darkness even darker, so that eventually, if she will continue like this, the God of this world, Satan, will finally blind her and she will never see the light of the glory of the gospel of Christ, who is the image of God. If people tarry too long and wait too long, it becomes too late, eternally. So, but in our case, verse 6, the opposite took place. He did in our case what he did in the case of the Apostle Paul. Although it did not always happen in our cases in such a dramatic manner. For God, who said, let light shine out of darkness, has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. God says, I want to give you light. I want to give you understanding of my glory. And therefore, he said, I enabled you to look into the face of the one who is the true light. How did John saw him on Patmos? His light shining, his face shining as the light of the sun in its brilliance. We haven't seen that face physically, but we have seen that face spiritually, and it was filled with spiritual light. And then I received knowledge as I looked into the face, the friendly face of the Lord Jesus Christ, my Savior and Lord. I received both light and life. I received understanding and fullness of life in and through him. And then I realized so much of the glory of my Father, because he is the image of the Father. He radiates the glory of the Father. And since that time, I could make progress with regard to receiving more light and more understanding, the light of more understanding, more joy, and more power in Christ and through him, by walking in the light, according to John 8, verse 12. What did God actually give us? 1 John 5, verse 20. You will see that these verses are so interconnected. The one author of it is, the final author are those who wrote Scripture. And we know that the Son of God, John says, the Son of God has come. And what has he given us? He has given us understanding. That means he has given us spiritual light so that we may know him who is true. That we may know the Father, who is the true one. And we are in him who is true. In his Son. We are also in his Son, Jesus Christ. He is a true God. And he is eternal life. God has given us understanding. Christ has given us understanding. The Father did that. The Holy Spirit did that. By showing us Christ. They took away the veil of ignorance. And not understanding, and we saw for the first time, and the moment we saw, we received that light and that life. But now, what should we do? Having received Christ as our light and our life, we have an obligation. We have to do what John says here in the next verse. Little children, keep yourselves from idols. Stay away from everything that pertains to the spiritual darkness. That which is contrary to the knowledge of God in Christ, as revealed in his word. Because we should never, never, never walk to a lesser degree than the fullest extent in the light of Christ, who is our light and our life. It is a path, the path of spiritual darkness and death, spiritual death for us, to shut out even a little bit of this knowledge of Christ and God's knowledge in and through Christ. Therefore, let us put him on. Lord, I put you on as my wisdom, because as your wisdom, you are my light. And the more light I receive in you, the more I receive your mind, and the more I can say, together with the Apostle Paul, I have the mind of Christ. I have the thinking of Christ. And therefore, in unity with the Lord Jesus Christ, as my wisdom, as my understanding, as my knowledge, I increasingly walk in the light, because it moves me forward. And I move forward with him, and I receive more and more of the fullness of life in and through him. That is not only true for us, brothers and sisters, as individual Christians. It is also true, should be true, of us as Christian churches, also of this church. The opposite, the exact opposite process happens in the case of those who remain in darkness. They do not have Christ as the life. And therefore, as John says in 1 John, they stumble around in the darkness. Their eyes get blinded more and more. What do we read in Proverbs 4 verse 18? We read that the light of the righteous shines always more brightly until the perfect day. Listen to this. The path of the righteous is like the light of the dawn, which shines brighter and brighter until the full day. Our light will increase because Christ moves us forward as he leads us. More knowledge, more understanding, more fullness of life. And fullness of life. And what have we already said during the previous sermons? What gets eliminated more and more as we walk with Christ? By putting him on in faith and moving in obedience with him. What gets eliminated is the darkness of ignorance. And we understand better and better, and we get to know his will better and better, and we move more and more in harmony with God, the Father, and the Son. And our light, the light of our joy and our fullness of the experience of his life increases. And it will continue to be like that until the perfect day will come when we will be with him in eternal glory. Then even our new bodies will shine with light as the sun. We shall shine from with an eternal spiritual light, because Christ is the lamp and the light of that city. And then the fullness of knowledge will be there, the fullness of understanding, the fullness of wisdom, and we will never be at odds with him. We will never walk contrary to him. We will always move in unity with him. And we will experience fullness of joy. The psalmist said, in his presence, there will be fullness of joy. You see, joy is also part of experiencing him as the light and the life, the knowledge and the fullness of life. For example, Revelation 19 verse 6. Let us rejoice and be glad, for the marriage feast of the Lamb has come, and his wife, his bride, has prepared herself, has made herself ready. Let us rejoice, let us be glad. The feast is there, the joy is there, because the fullness of light and life is there. The more of Christ there is, the more of joy there will be, the more of this lovely experience of him as our fullness. Now, the opposite is also a process. But it is a process in the opposite direction. Listen to verse 19. I read again 18. The path of a righteous is like the light of dawn. It shines brighter and brighter until the full day or perfect day. But the way of the wicked is like deep darkness. They do not know over what they stumble. Everywhere we read about the spiritual darkness in which the lost find themselves in, we read that they stumble in darkness. They do not know what they're doing. This darkness has blinded their eyes. The Lord Jesus said in the Gospels, let your eye, brother, be single and let it be healthy. Because if that is the case, your entire body will be filled with light. If our understanding of Christ and the fullness in him is in accordance with Scripture, and it is not only black letters on white paper, our entire spiritual being will be filled with more and more blazing light. And the experience of his fullness will increase all the time. One of my favorite verses, if I had been younger, I would have made a plaque and put it onto my wall. 1 John 2 verse 8. First letter of John, chapter 2 and verse 8. At the same time, it is a new commandment, John says, that I am writing to you, which is true in him and in you. This commandment is true in Christ and in you. Because, why? Because the darkness is passing away, and the true light is already shining. The true light, Christ, has already appeared, and we are in him. Because God has granted us understanding and wisdom and knowledge in him, and therefore the fullness of life, as we receive that knowledge and understanding, him as our wisdom and fullness. And therefore there's a process here involved. He says, the darkness is already passing away. It hasn't passed away in 1 second. It passes away to some extent, in some measure, and then more and more. During our holiday in Tergnit, I would get up at 4:30 and I would wait for the dawning of the day, looking over the ocean. And I would say at a certain stage, 4:45, whatever, there would be the first little glimmering. And I looked and looked, I put on my glasses and my spectacles to see better. And I kept looking and I saw, but the light is increasing. It's becoming more and more glorious. The glorious South African coastal sun. Until it was a blazing light. And illuminated the ocean. You see, this is the way things happen. The light, as it continues to shine more brightly and more brilliantly, it increasingly drives out the darkness. The more bright the light, the brighter the light, the more fully it exterminates the darkness. The darkness has to flee before it. And this is what should happen in the body of Christ. But let me say this, that light has a way of penetrating. And as it penetrates further and further, the darkness disappears. There is some darkness in us still, right? Some hidden places of ignorance that we do not know about. But as I said this morning, the more we will walk with Christ, commune with him as our wisdom, as our knowledge, as our fullness of life, by putting him on in faith as our armory. We will, armory means that he's our weapon. To do what? To exterminate the darkness that is still in us and still in our midst. How did it work in the case of the church in Jerusalem? The gospel was proclaimed. Christ was proclaimed. The people got saved. Brilliantly and gloriously saved. They were filled with night, the knowledge of Christ and the joy of Christ. And they knew where they were going. They knew, we are here to save people. We are here to show Christ. We know exactly what we're doing. We're not stumbling around in darkness. And the light increased, right? Every time somebody tried to stop the outshining of the light of Christ through the gospel, God stopped it. Christ stopped it as the Lord of Lords, the reigning King of all reigners and kings. And all who reign, and a governor, a magician got blinded so that the governor could believe. And one thing happened after the other, but then we come to Acts chapter 5, and I know we have looked at this many times, but I want us to have another look at it. Acts chapter 5 and verse 5. When Ananias heard these words, you have been lying to the Holy Spirit, not to men. And he fell down and he breathed his last breath. He died. He expired. And what happened then? Great fear came upon all who heard it. Would you also have experienced great fear? God's apostle says, you lied to the Holy Spirit. You lied in the sphere where the Holy Spirit gives us the light and the knowledge and the fullness of life in Christ. You broke the unity of the body. You brought some spiritual darkness into the body of Christ. And he's the light here. Therefore, you worked against the Holy Spirit. Therefore, the Holy Spirit is now going to destroy you. And he fell down dead, dropped down dead. Great fear came upon them. We are not allowed to bring in the slightest little bit of darkness into the light of Christ's presence, because we cannot allow dusk to come. The Germans say Dämmerung. Dusk is bad in a spiritual sense. It might be very romantic for you and your wife to take your to hold hands and to walk in the dusk before it becomes totally dark. But in a spiritual sense, dusk is very bad. It should be brilliant light as opposed to total and utter darkness. Because according to Malachi 3, God has one world plan, and that is to show the separation between the two, between light and darkness. And what was God doing and Christ by killing and destroying Ananias? He was eliminating the darkness that Satan smuggled into the body to cause dusk to reign instead of brilliant light. But that was not the end. The light always shines further and further. And therefore, the next point was, the next thing that happened was, according to verse, his wife also died in the same way for the same reason. She also brought some darkness of hypocrisy and lying into the body. The Holy Spirit said, I'm not going to allow it. Christ said, I'm not going to allow it. I'm busy filling my body with my light and my life. I'm busy with this revival. And I'm not going to allow you to stop this. She also died. And then, what happened then? Great fear came upon all those within the church and outside of the church. The fear inside of the church was the fear of respect for Christ, who is the light of life and who is full life and full knowledge and wisdom. And therefore they walked with him even more carefully. And as they walked with him, the disciples, even more carefully, the Holy Spirit worked in the lives of some who were lost, and multitudes of them got saved, and each one became a light in the Lord Jesus. And three, do you remember Ephesians 5, verse 8? Previously you used to be darkness. Now you have become light in the Lord Jesus. And three, walk in the light and extinguish and exterminate the works of darkness, exposing it by through your lives, living as you should live in righteousness, as we said this morning, in the fullness of Christ. And as they did that, a multitude of men and women believed in Christ, and the light became more and more in a numerical sense and in a qualitative sense. But we also read that none of those who were outsiders, who did not believe in Christ, dared join them. There was too much fear upon them. The fear of God was upon them. We cannot join these people. The light will slay us. The light will kill us. Because this light is moving forward in triumph. Christ the light is moving forward and is causing the kingdom to come in his church and through his church. You see, this is what should happen. Do you understand? The same process has been going on in our church that we read here. The light is shining more brightly. And as it moves forward, and as we move forward, as this church moves forward in the knowledge of Christ and in the fullness of his life, the more the Holy Spirit worked and the more clearly he spoke to the lost. And those who didn't want to believe moved away. And those who were like Ananias and Sapphira, Christ did not kill them. He would maybe have if we had been in the full blaze of revival. But because there's still some dusk in our midst, he just took them away. And what remained? More light remained. As God, in this way, separated light from darkness, the light shone more brightly and more brilliantly. Brothers and sisters, tonight we have more light in this church. The light of Christ. The light of knowledge in him and wisdom to know how to move forward in him. Than we have had since we started. Since 2 years ago. Since a year ago. Since 6 months ago. Than 6 months ago. We are making progress. The Lord is making progress. His light is shining. He is shining as the light. As the knowledge. As the wisdom, but he uses us as his co-workers. What a ministry to expose the darkness of ignorance in order to spread the light, which brings the fullness of the life of Christ. And we should continue in this way until we will be with him in the day when the light will be all-encompassing and all-enveloping. Beloved, I thought about a few points. How should we go about it to eliminate the darkness of ignorance and disobedience that is still in us? Okay, a few points. John 7, verse 17. John chapter 7, verse 17. It is all, we start with the attitude or the disposition of the heart, the inward disposition and attitude. If anyone, Jesus the Lord said, is willing to do God's will, or if anyone's will is to do God's will, my translation says he will know whether the teaching is from God or whether I am speaking on my own authority. Who are the people who really eventually knew that we were speaking the truth here? That we were proclaiming the right message? Those who were willing to know God's will. Lord, we want to know. And who were, on the contrary, those who said, I cannot understand what he's saying. He's speaking in blank verse, or as somebody said, in black reverse. I was an English teacher, and instead of saying he spoke in blank verse, he said he was speaking in blank reverse. We really had a good laugh, Susan and I. It was a little funny. But those who are not willing for the light to penetrate, what happens to them? They are in darkness already. They are without the life of Christ. Christ who is the life. They are without the knowledge of Christ, the wisdom of Christ. And the more they move forward, they stumble more and more, and the darkness in them grows more intense and envelops them fully eventually until God says, I give you over first time. Romans 1:24. I give you over to your own lust the second time. Romans 1:26. I give you over for the third time. Romans 1:28. And the third time is the final time. And then God gives them over to a reprobate mind. That means God says, I will never allow you to see the light. You will never understand anything correctly. You will never see Christ as the true knowledge and the true wisdom. You will always remain in darkness. You will never think straight again. I took away your ability to think straight and to think right. And then God says, okay, that was the second last step. Now I come to the last step. There's enough darkness in you. That's what you wanted. Do you remember our message of this morning? Whatever a man sows, that he shall also reap. They sow darkness and rebellion, and they reaped more darkness. God says, you want darkness? I'll give you darkness. I take away your ability to think correctly, and I take away my spirit. He will never speak to you again. But God says, in order to seal their faith, 2 Thessalonians 2, I sent them, as he did in the case of King Saul, wicked King Saul, lost King Saul, who had been anointed to be the king of Israel, but was never a saved man. Never had the spirit, never prayed like David. Never take away your spirit from me, O Lord. Never take away your light from me, O Lord. Show me the darkness, O Lord, David said, that is in me. I want to take it away so that I can become light in you fully. An evil spirit, it is an interesting way in which it's written in the Hebrew even. An evil spirit of God. Can you believe it? An evil spirit of God. He sent to Saul. In order to delude him into total darkness. And that is what happens to the people according to 2 Thessalonians. God says, now I'm going to seal you for the Antichrist. The Antichrist will soon do mighty wonders and false wonders and have a false teaching, a false truth. But God says, I will send you as I sent King Saul, because he was not willing, according to John 7:17. He didn't want to know. He shut out the light. Therefore, the law of sowing and reaping function in your case in the following way. I will send them the spirit of delusion in order for them to believe the lie. God says, I now want you to believe the lie. You're going to believe the lie. You're going to believe in the Antichrist and the false prophet and the beast. You will now believe in the unholy Trinity instead of in the Holy Trinity. But you see, God is giving us more and more light and knowledge in and through Christ as we move forward with him in obedience, right? And we experience more knowledge, more wisdom, and more fullness of life. Through Christ, who is the light of life. And the fullness of light and life. Their process is the exact opposite. Okay, let us finish the sermon, because I'm not going to be able to finish it in any case, in the way I wanted to. We're not in revival time, so I'm not that, don't have like the Puritans, a sand glass that I can turn over two times, meaning they were allowed to preach for 3 hours. We're not in those times. So I have to finish and start making my landing. But the point is this, that the Holy Spirit is willing to show us what is in our hearts. What do we read about in 1 John 4 verse 5? I mentioned that last time. I mean 1 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 5. 1 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 5. Therefore, do not pronounce judgment before the time. Do not pronounce judgment on the others before the time, before the Lord Jesus comes. We will bring to light the things now hidden in darkness and will disclose the purposes of the heart. And then each one will receive his commendation or his praise from God. Arthur Wallace said, he wrote many books on various books on revival. And I read it last night, and I agree with him, that what we do not deal with now in this life with regard to our hypocrisy, our lack of full openness and seriousness, the things that we retain in our lives and hearts will have to be reckoned with and be dealt with before we will partake of the marriage feast of the Lamb and be his bride forever in eternity. What is not dealt with now will be dealt with at the judgment seat of Christ. We're now talking about the saved. Some darkness is remaining of disobedience, of rebellion, of impure motives, of lack of full knowledge, and therefore lack of fully dealing with our sins. And he says, when Christ will appear before him, in the case of every Christian, he's going to bring out the things of darkness, in his, starting with his motive, and then the rest, and then he will exterminate it. And for what will remain, he will give us praise. His Father will give us praise. But as Arthur Wallace said, how ashamed we will be that things that we should have dealt with here will have to, before an assembled universe of all God's flaming angels, bright and shining angels, and his, and in the presence of even Satan and his demons, and no, not really them, and God's saints, he will say, John or Peter or Sarah, whoever, you know that you had to deal with that, but you only took some half measures. Now I have to bring it to the fore, because you hadn't been a spiritually violent enough person. You didn't deal drastically and radically with the darkness that is in you of ignorance and sin and impure motives and deeds and half measures. I now expose them, I exterminate them. You lose your reward to that extent that I have to remove that and destroy that. You should actually have received a full reward, but you're not going to get your full reward. You're missing part of it. But for what will remain over, remain after that, that will be pure light and life in Christ. Pure gold, silver, and precious stones in a spiritual sense. For that we will receive praise not only from the Lord Jesus, but from the Father as well. Why not rather deal with those things now? Why not rather let the light shine through and say, Lord, we must become fully obedient. Give us light one step at a time. This is just a different image, but it's the same message as the message of this morning. In the message of this morning, we had the agricultural illustration. This evening, we have the illustration of light versus darkness. But it is all in and through our Lord Jesus Christ. Let us put him on as our armor, as our weapon, to drive out the darkness even in ourselves. The darkness of ignorance, the darkness of disobedience, of impure motives and wrong deeds, instead of righteousness. Because these things rob us of our joy in the Lord, and the more we will become filled with him as our light and life, the more joy we will experience, and the better we will be filled with him as our power, and the better we will fight for the Lord. What the Lord was actually doing in the case of the church of Jerusalem, he wanted to exterminate the darkness fully so that the entire body of Christ would be as full with the light of Christ as humanly possible. And that he did. And therefore he slayed this, that and the next. And the gospel triumph and Christ triumphs through his people. Do you think that the Lord Jesus Christ is actually the same yesterday, today and forever? Or not? Do you think that he still is will for this little church? Do you think he also wants to increasingly drive out the darkness, but first in us, so that great fear will come upon us, the fear of the respect for God and for Christ, and we walk humbly and contritely before him and in the fullness of his blazing light, and we will come instruments of spreading his light and his life, and many will be saved, and he will build the church that will overcome the darkness by destroying increasingly the darkness and the death in the lost, as he will save them and then enable them to walk in him who is the light of life as well. I wanted to say so many more things, but I hope you got the gist of the message, the essence of it. There must be a progression. There is, in fact, a progression, either in one direction or in another, in the case of every church, in the case of every individual Christian, of every Christian family, of every Christian married couple. They're moving forward or they're moving backwards. But we should move forward. More light, more knowledge, more joy, more understanding, more wisdom, more power in Christ and through him, by using him as our weapon to drive out ignorance, disobedience, rebellion, impure motives, lack of unity, and to experience his fullness of him as our fullness of life in the fullness of his joy. And then we will be filled, beloved people, with him through the Spirit, and we will many to him. And it will come always more light in all the senses. Do you think it's worth it? Let's go that way. Amen. Heavenly Father, please enable us to go the right route. O Lord, those who are here who do not know you, please, won't you shine upon them and give them light? Illuminate them. Let them see you as the light and the life of men and women. Let them become light in the Lord Jesus so that they can together with us follow you and glorify you fully. So that your kingdom will come as it came in the case of the church of Jerusalem, in an always and ever increasing manner, in an ever increasing degree, and to an ever increasing measure, until we will be appear before your judgment seat, not to have many things exposed that will be wrong, if at all possible. O Lord, let it be as little as possible, if at all. So, because we want to receive our full reward in and through you, we thank you, Father in heaven, that you gave us your all. Not your best only, your all. When you gave us your Son, he's our weapon against the darkness of ignorance and of disobedience and of a lack of wisdom and of rebellion and of a lack of joy. So that we can become united in you and see you mightily working and drive out the darkness and do the same through us, through our ministries in the lives of many others. And God's people said,
Amen.
Amen.